In my remarks to the 2013 General Assembly at Cherry Hills, I said that it was time for the EPC to move from a period of transfer growth to transformation growth. Since June of last year, moving from transfer to transformation has resonated well and gained significant traction with leaders throughout the EPC. As the idea of moving from transfer to transformation developed, it became obvious to the Committee on Administration, which I liken to the session or the national leadership team of the EPC, it was obvious to us that we did not want to organize ourselves in order to become an institution. That is, we do not want to build a bureaucracy at the national level of our church. We believe that Jesus has called us to do something else. And that something else is what we want to report to you today. We're going to present to you the following. We're going to provide some background. At its meetings since our General Assembly last June, the Committee on Administration has addressed how to articulate transfer to transformation as a movement now that we have more than 500 churches. We're going to talk about our mission, that is who we understand we are. Dean Weaver is going to share with you thoughts about a statement of vision. And he will then speak to some current strategies that we're aware of and are pursuing. And then Scott Griffin and Bill Enns will talk about some open doors of opportunity we believe the Lord has for us as we move from transfer to transformation. And then lastly, we want to give you our thoughts about where we go from here and how you can participate in this process. Be assured, this is a work in progress, and we need your help. We all need to be involved in this. We understand the term mission to be who we are. Our mission statement is the EPC exists to carry out the Great Commission of Jesus as a denomination of Presbyterian, Reformed, Evangelical, and missional congregations. This is how we have defined ourselves across the last 6 years, and it is the starting point for what comes next. I'll turn it over now to Dean Weaver.
Thanks, Jeff. So if Jesus is the mission of God, the Missio Dei, and he is, then as he dwells in us, the hope of glory, we become God's mission to the world. Mission is a statement of being, of who we are. But if that's who we are, God's mission to the world, then what's that look like? And how will we know when we've arrived there? Well, those are questions of vision. Vision is a clear, compelling, preferred future of what God would give us and lead us to be. You're probably familiar with Proverbs 29:18 that says, where there is no vision, the people perish. I prefer the translation that says, where there is no revelation, people wander unrestrained. And so this is not about our trying to come up with something clever. This is about discerning what God is revealing in our midst and then seeking to follow after him to be a part of something that God is doing in the world. Rather than doing something and saying, why doesn't God come and join us? We want to discern what God is doing and go and join him in his great mission to the world. So let's take a look at that vision statement that is out there beginning to germinate among a number of groups within our body. To the glory of God, the EPC aspires to be a global movement of congregations engaged together in God's mission through transformation, multiplication, and effective biblical leadership, embodying Jesus' love to our neighbors near and far. Would you sign up for something like that? We're not just about a destination. Okay, you've arrived. Your first General Assembly, you're here. No, it's more than that. We believe God is taking us someplace, And this is the beginning of an articulation of what we think that preferred future might just look like. Let's break it down very briefly. First of all, to the glory of God. Grounding from the very beginning in that great sola of the Reformation, that summary statement of who we are right out of our confession, to the glory of God. We don't want to do anything unless it brings him the glory. The EPC aspires, and vision statements are aspirations. They are things that you'll see some elements of already, but they're things that we're moving towards by God's grace. The EPC aspires to be a global movement. Think about that for 1 second. It's already happening in your local congregations as many of our churches move from writing out a check to an organization to rolling up our sleeves and standing side by side with indigenous leaders in developing countries and the two-thirds world's nations and starting to see the kingdom of God advance in a way in likes of which we've never seen before. It's happening at our presbytery levels as we're joining together and doing the same things. And you see it and world outreach. You see it in the Engage 2025. There are so many initiatives and ways in which, and there are churches around the globe that are seeing what God is doing in the EPC and saying, we would like to be a part of what God is doing through you. So we're not sure altogether what this means yet, but we know that we're not called to be some sort of cloistered American church, but we're called to be part of a global movement of congregations engaged together. That's a way of saying we're actually Presbyterian, we mean it, and we like it. We're not congregational, we're not out there on our own. Churches that want to be left alone, God love them. But we believe that we're stronger together than apart, and we need one another. It's happening in clusters of churches and local communities, presbyteries, and even in settings like this, where best practices enable us to engage together in God's mission. You know, and some people say, that the church has a mission. I would say, no, God's mission has a church. And that's who we are, that we are engaged together in God's mission through transformation. And that's what this vision statement's all about. It's not just enough to say all these people are transferring to us. We're now talking about being transformed as God does that work of renewal in our body. I'm going to need that slide back whenever you guys get that. I know the next one. After that, I'm lost. Through transformation and multiplication. Now, multiplication, you go back to Genesis, and we're not just talking about the Great Commission. We'll get to that in 1 second. What about the Great Command, or what about the cultural mandate of be fruitful and multiply? We're called to be fruitful and multiply. There were 240 people, I understand, at a church revitalization luncheon today, wanting to know how to be more fruitful. You heard Tom Ricks talk earlier about this whole idea of church planting, which is gaining traction. And so that's not just transformation, but that's transformation and multiplication in the advance of the kingdom and the glory of God. And how do we do that? Through effective biblical leadership. And we have those words together purposefully because there are a lot of folks out there in Christendom who are endeavoring to be effective, who we think maybe have left beside those biblical foundations and roots. And there's a lot of people who moor down so deeply in those biblical foundation and roots, they haven't really given an eye toward being effective. We don't think they're mutually exclusive of one another. We think that we can be effective biblical leaders, just as our Savior was, doing what? Embodying his love to neighbors near and far. That is, in essence, the Great Commission. That's in our mission statement. That's who we are. We're God's mission to the world, and we believe God is taking this global movement of engaged Presbyterian congregations to join his mission in transformation and multiplication to take effective biblical leaders out into the world, near and far, to the ends of the earth, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, with the gospel. Now, here's the thing. As a pastor, the majority of what I do is not prescribe what we should do, but describe what God is doing and invite people to go join that. There are some ongoing strategies that are already occurring that show us that this vision statement is not from ourselves, but is something God is actually doing. Just take a look at three really quick ongoing strategies that are already occurring. You have seen, you have heard, and you will continue to hear about these church planting strategies. Had the chance to be with Tim Keller at dinner last night, and he was talking about urban church planting. It is growing at an exponential rate, and we get to be a part of that. It's already happening, not just in our presbyteries, but churches, individuals, clusters of churches that are planting And we can be a part of that. That's one of the strategies that's already happening. Another strategy that's already happening is last year at our assembly, we commissioned a group to look at this idea of credentialing and ordination and how we can serve congregations on the front line of ministries, continuing to find creative ways to move forward with our historic standards. And that is in process. That's already occurring. And finally, to engage unreached people groups around the world. World Outreach in Engage 2025 is already doing that, and many of your congregations and presbyteries have joined in partnering in that activity. These are strategies that are already occurring that are moving us toward this vision, and yet we've identified gaps that aren't occurring and are hoping to develop new strategies to help us move faithfully toward what God has revealed for us so we don't wander around unrestrained. And so Scott Griffin is going to talk to us a little bit about some of those new strategies in terms of how we might move forward.
Thank you, brother. Amen. Well, I love the passion that Dean shared. He shared that same passion as we were talking about vision on the Committee on Administration. I want to underline that many of you helped create that vision. That is not a top-down vision. That is a vision that, as we discern where the Holy Spirit is leading us as a denomination, we captured those words. And so that is our target. I'd like to describe four additional strategies, and these are not in cement yet. As a matter of fact, the wet cement isn't even poured around them. We'd like to involve you in these four strategies, but first let me tell you what our process was. We created a vision statement. Where is God leading us? Where is the Holy Spirit leading us? And then Dean mentioned gaps. The gaps are when we looked at where are we today, and where do we want to be, and there's a gap, and we identified a number of strategies that would address those gaps, two pages of strategies. And the last thing we did was, let's pick the big swingers, let's pick the ones we should be working on first. So it's my pleasure to take you through what those four are, and at the end we're going to ask you for your input, did we get the right four? So the first one, this is going to look familiar, promote and resource church planning. Why did we write that as a new strategy? Because of the word resource. So we heard this fantastic presentation today with passion about 13 church plants in the last year. All of us are going to parent, partner, and patron. Residencies going from 3 to 5. I think we need to think about what kind of, and this is going to happen at the church and the presbytery level, not at General Assembly. We want to think about what resources are necessary to make that happen. What about presbyteries that are being held back because they don't think they have the resources? What would happen if money wasn't an issue when we look at church planting? So this isn't a new strategy, but it's an addition to the strategy you saw on the previous page. Second, we just heard from Dean about an exciting lunch where we talked about church revitalization. This is a sister strategy to church planting. We heard this morning from John Wood the state of our church in the United States, and we actually have churches in the EPC that have flat membership or declining. How do we come along those pastors, alongside those pastors and elders, and do we have best practices? I was excited. We looked this morning at St. Andrew's Kirk in the Bahamas. There's some best practices there besides that video that need to be captured. We need to have the same amount of passion about church revitalization as we do about church planting. And we think if we call that out as a strategy, we'll begin to think about that together. Third, create a structure suitable for global movement. Dean indicated we're already becoming global. We have churches in Sierra Leone, and we have affiliations in South America and Africa and Europe. We'd like to think about what should our denomination look like in 3 years. Today, our presbyteries are within the boundaries of the United States. Do we have presbyteries outside the United States in 3 years? Is that where God is leading us? Is that the most effective way for us to seek out his mission for us as a denomination? And then finally, and these are in no particular order, by the way, we have create a leadership development approach. And this is a strategy that has already got some traction. My friend and colleague Bill Enns has been working on this. The under 40 pastors have been thinking about this, Women in Ministry Committee. Some good work's already being done. I'm a ruling elder, and I like to think of this strategy as what is our nurturing strategy for ruling and teaching elders, all the way from the call through their career. And the young pastors are telling us, we have little pockets of mentoring. How come we're not all being mentored? Pastors who get their first senior pastor opportunity need to be mentored and nurtured by people who have been there that know what the challenges are going to be. So these don't look like new strategies. This again is evidence that the vision statement is solid, is coming from God. I'd like to challenge you to help us with these. Are these the right four, now seven? Should it be 10? Should it be four? Should it be three? We'd like to engage you in the process. We don't want this to be a top-down process. We want to work together to discern God's will for our church. So I'm going to hand it over to my colleague, Bill Enns, to talk about that fourth strategy.
Thank you, Scott. Scott's already mentioned the fact that we have already had conversations with a number of groups on the vision statement, and we're hoping that you really like the vision statement, but not so much that you are afraid to take a look at it and begin with us the process of thinking this through. As we talked about this, one of the things that we decided was that we wanted to be a global movement, not a static institution. The difference between a movement and an institution is a movement has a vision, it has a purpose, it has a goal. An institution is only concerned with preserving itself. Because of that, we have to come up with appropriate strategies to help us become the movement we say we want to be. We asked three questions as we began this process. The first question, what kind of congregation do we want the EPC to be at the local level? What kind of presbytery facilitates that kind of congregation? And what kind of General Assembly level resources that kind of presbytery and that congregation in order that we might become the people that God created us to be? Here's what we determined. We determined that the most significant area of growth and the most important entry point into our leadership process is the local congregation. We are engaged together to fulfill God's mission. If we are engaged together, our preferred future has to be to engage together in identifying leaders for the Church of Jesus Christ. And that is a congregational moment. Every other court in the Presbyterian system is ruled by people who were identified at the local level. So we want to be engaged together to identify and affirm candidates for ministry and officers for the church. Our preferred future is that they be identified at the local level. Today, many of the candidates for office have a tendency to self-identify. That's not always bad because we do believe in the internal call, but it has to be vetted by a discerning body of Christ. I remind you, dear ones, and I do consider you dear, by the way, I remind you that the primary duty, the first duty of an elder is what? To represent the mind of Christ. And I want to remind you that that is together, not alone. So in the process of identifying candidates for ministry and candidates for ruling elder, we need to clearly articulate a spiritual vision. We also want to make sure that our sessions are truly spiritual leadership and not simply boards of directors. The default position in every organization, I don't care what it is, the default position is always the default to doing the stuff that's in front of you and lose sight of the mission. And when that happens, you get lots of rules and very little action. So we want elders to be identified as spiritual leaders. Because of that, I have to tell you candidly, the terms that we use, teaching elder, ruling elder, I have another one at the national level I just love, stated clerk. Exactly. We don't know what that means. It doesn't communicate anything that has to do with the mission, does it? Okay, those are some of the conversations that we are having right now. What is it that we can do to make what we believe God has called us to be crystal clear so that the world understands? Because our audience is not other Presbyterian denominations, not even other Presbyterian churches within our own denomination. Our mission field is the world. And how they perceive us is more important than anything else. We want to make sure that sessions are vision-driven rather than simply institutional in their orientation. At the presbytery level, I'm only going to mention one, and that is the presbytery level, we want to make sure that our pastors are cared for. You realize, I know you do because you're all elders in the Presbyterian Church, that those of us who are pastors will never be members of a congregation. We are only members of the presbytery. So the presbytery is our church. Pastoral care for pastors is critical there. And then at the General Assembly level, this is where we have been doing a lot of our work. We want to make sure that as we work toward leadership development, we resource, not direct. I'm going to do with you what I do with my congregation. We are not here to direct. We are here to resource because we believe, as Dean said earlier, that the mission of God in the world has a church. And the church needs to organize itself in such a way that it deploys spiritually mature, vibrant, vital people for the sake of the world. In order to make all of that happen, we're going to be taking a look at all of our structures, at the titles that we use, not just because we want to throw things up in the air, but because we believe that ultimately there is a real possibility of transformation for the sake of the world. The last thing that I want to say to you is, as part of that resourcing, one of the things that we have talked about, we've heard it from our under 40 pastors, pastors who are under the age of 40, not fewer than 40, never mind. One of the things that they have asked for from us is mentoring and coaching. And one of the things that I would like to help you understand is the difference between a mentor and a coach. A mentor generally is someone within the chain of command of a given congregation who is training a person in their chain of command to grow them to more effective ministry. A coach usually comes alongside someone who has taken a position that they have never had before, and they need someone to come alongside who is outside of the chain of command who can help them process their stuff. In a nutshell, our passion, our goal, is to deploy congregations that are fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ. We want to have presbyteries whose passion is to build that kind of congregation, and a General Assembly-wide office that resources to the greater glory of God. Now, to bring this all home, the one and only stated clerk, Jeff Jeremiah.
Thank you. I'm glad my phone is on vibrate. You have been emailing and Twittering me, and I thought I was having a heart attack there. Well, before we address next steps, I just want to quickly recap what's already in progress. First, you received an update this morning from the church planting team led by Tom Ricks. Tomorrow morning, you'll hear from Ken Pretty, and the task force that is doing church revitalization work for our churches. And one of our goals is to nationalize that ministry. You will also hear tomorrow from Fred Leon and members of the Interim Committee on Ministerial Education, which is tackling one aspect of this leadership development issue. So, where do we go from here? We believe it's imperative that we engage together in this as leaders in God's church, teaching elders and ruling elders. We have already begun this engagement process with a number of groups, including our under 40-year-old teaching elders, whom we are calling next generation leaders. And it was a surprise to me, and it may be a surprise to you, that we have over 185 teaching elders in the EPC who are under the age of 40, or they look like they're under the age of 40. COA members have joined me at meals that we have hosted to initiate the conversation with our next generation leaders in Mid-Atlantic, Pacific, East, Southeast, and Midwest Presbyteries. And we're hoping to arrange face-to-face meetings with our next generation leaders in the rest of our presbyteries by the end of the year. Next, we want to drive a dynamic process with the understanding that this is an ongoing work. There will certainly be decisions made along the way, but this is not an event, it is a process. We've made a point to get help in order to drive this process well. Brian Smith, whom you will hear from later at the assembly, was hired as our Director of Communications in April of this year, and we have retained a consultant to devise a communication strategy that includes how to make this happen. Next, as we move forward together in this process, we will hold each other accountable, because that's a part of what it means to be a connectional church, to be connected together as brothers and sisters in Christ. We will utilize existing resources and funding. This is not an exercise in wishful thinking. Because the session of the EPC has not built a bureaucracy, the national level of the church in the last 7 years, we have the financial resources available to fund these strategic opportunities. Lastly, the Committee on Administration will provide an update to you at each General Assembly. Now, to get this conversation started, we would love to hear from you, get your ideas and comments. Please email your input to me at jeff.jeremiah@epc.org. We will compile everyone's thoughts through the rest of the summer. Respond to some Twitters and emails. We are also planning to post on our website this presentation as a Word document, as well as a video presentation of this material in the weeks ahead. Transfer to transformation. This is what we believe our future is in Jesus Christ. Trusting the Lord himself will lead us, and he will empower us. We will be in touch as together we proceed into this future we believe that he has for us. Thank you very much.